declared the United Nations Conference on the Exploration and Peaceful Uses of Outer Space, Unispace, and called to order this first meeting. Allow me to extend to all a very warm welcome. In accordance with Rule 8 of the Provisional Rules of Procedure of the Conference, I wish to call the conference. I wish to inform the conference that I will serve as temporary president of the conference until the election of the president. I would now like to invite His Excellency Mr. Thomas Plessy, Federal President of the Republic of Austria, to address the conference.
Mr. Secretary General, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the Republic of Austria, I welcome you to the third UN Conference on the Exploration and the Peaceful Use of Outer Space. I'm particularly pleased that the Secretary General of the United Nations has joined us on this occasion. Your presence here, Mr. Secretary General, is highly appreciated, and we are grateful for your support of Vienna as one of the major centers of the World Organization. Unispace 3 is a most timely and innovative event for a number of reasons. First, tomorrow it will be exactly 30 years that Neil Armstrong set foot on the moon. This historic achievement has inaugurated a new era of mankind. The exploration of outer space has changed our perspective in fundamental ways. For the first time, we can look at our world in its totality. The picture of Earth taken from outer space has revealed the unique beauty of our planet and its great vulnerability. It has become the very embodiment of a new sense of global community, making it all the more essential that the spirit of consensus and cooperation in space activities will be further strengthened. Second, the most promising way of such cooperation is manned space flight. The new International Space Station will really be mankind's outpost in space. Today we can only speculate about the new findings and discoveries that will be sparked by this great endeavor in such diverse fields as life sciences, material sciences, and technological development. Especially at a time when armed conflict has once again become, unfortunately, a frequent reality, even at the center of Europe. It is all the more urgent to remind ourselves of the responsibilities which we have taken upon us for peace and security here on Earth. Third, Unispace 3 will be the first global conference of the United Nations with industry and civil society to participate as full partners of governments. This reflects the increasing economic use of outer space and the rapidly growing importance of private companies in this area. Moreover, it reflects the heightened interest of citizens in matters related to outer space. Let me congratulate you, Mr. Secretary General, on this new approach, which represents a fundamental change in the attitude of the United Nations. It is a timely recognition of the fact that governments are no longer the sole actors, not even the most important actors, when it comes to space applications. In a number of areas, from satellite communications to launch services, the space industry has outpaced government involvement. The space exhibition which runs parallel to this conference, displays state-of-the-art space technology for some of the leading aerospace manufacturers, government agencies, and civilian organizations. And it constitutes a unique opportunity to meet and establish new partnerships. Fourth, Unispace 3 is based on the conviction that the future of mankind lies with the young people. Possibilities have always been matched by new responsibilities. I'm optimistic that Unispace 3 will reach its two main goals: to promote effective means of using space solutions to address problems of regional and global significance, and to strengthen the capability of member states to use the results of space research for social, economic, and cultural development. Today, space technology has become part of our lives at a degree which was unimaginable only a few years ago. But it can even do more to promote sustainable development and to monitor events that may endanger the well-being and livelihood of large numbers of people. Unless the developed world is prepared to share its technological know-how with the developing countries, the benefits of space applications will remain curtailed to the detriment of both sides. Developing countries need to improve their national capabilities, and the United Nations are called upon to ensure access to the knowledge and skills required for the peaceful uses of outer space. I appeal to all of you, the representatives of governments, private industry, and of non-governmental organizations, to actively support UN activities and initiatives in this field in order to make space knowledge a major contribution to human progress. I believe that Unispace 3 is an ideal platform to promote the involvement of a larger number of developing countries in international research programs. Increasing changes in the biosphere.
I am delighted to join you today. Of all the important and challenging topics on the agenda of the United Nations, perhaps none quite captures our imagination like outer space. You need only look up at the stars to be filled with a sense of wonder that has spurred men and women to explore outer space. But outer space does not only stir the soul, it also has great practical implications for the lives of people everywhere. It is those implications we are here to discuss. Unispace 3 is the last major UN conference this century. As such, it is a fitting symbol both of the achievements of the last 100 years and of the work of the United Nations. We are at the end of a century that has been unparalleled, has seen unparalleled progress in science and technology. In many ways, the pinnacle of these achievements was the birth of space technology, with which we finally realized the dream of venturing beyond our own planet. The exploration of outer space has already revolutionized life on our planet in many ways. It has ushered in the satellite age, making possible the phenomenon we have come to know as globalization. Every time live television images are transmitted across continents, every time capital is moved by pressing a few keys on a computer terminal, and every time the internet puts new stores of information at our fingertips, we can thank the pioneering efforts of space technology which have allowed us to conquer the barriers of distance. Other applications of space technology are less obvious, but no less important. For instance, observations from space have allowed us to better understand our environment. For example, by imaging the ozone layer or well climate conditions. And space technology has led to advances in fields as diverse as the monitoring of natural disasters and the development of navigational systems. These examples of space technology, some immediately apparent, some much less so, provide a powerful justification for carrying on with our basic research in space science. Our collective knowledge may be enriched in ways which today we cannot even imagine. Meanwhile, we can make much more use of what we already know. We can ensure that educational resources and medical expertise reach the remote communities in the world. With over 1 billion people remaining illiterate in the world, surely this must be one of our first priorities. We can gather information that will allow us to locate and suitably manage natural resources, an application especially useful in view of the growing threats to our global environment. We can improve our weather forecasting and use it to minimize the effects of natural disasters. We can use experimentation in space to develop innovative agricultural techniques sorely needed in regions of the world where people still go hungry, even while the world supposedly has the technology to feed its people many times over. And we can use satellite monitoring to detect landmines and even the cultivation of plants used to make illicit drugs. And President Purcell referred to this earlier. Indeed, our own UN International Drug Control Program, based here in Vienna, has recently signed an important agreement with the European Space Agency for that very purpose. In short, the potential is really great. But there are dangers as well. Unfortunately, the advantages of globalization are far from being equally accessible to all human beings. For example, the telecommunications industry is estimated to be worth $1 trillion annually of space as another battleground for our earthly conquests. On the contrary, we must ensure that the fruits of technological progress are made available to all people in all nations. This is an important aspect of global development and therefore of direct concern to the United Nations. We must find ways to lower the cost of technologies associated with space science and to provide developing countries with the resources to acquire them. We must also persuade policymakers to acknowledge and pursue the practical benefits of space technology for development on an equal footing. We can go even further and speak of partnership across generations. This conference's Space Generation Forum is an invaluable tool for including young people in discussions on outer space. Young people, perhaps most of all, are inspired by the potential of space exploration to hope, dream, and work together. It is the young that we must look to for the scientific breakthroughs of tomorrow. I am sure we have future world leaders amongst us here today. What they will learn at this conference, notably by exchanging information and ideas in the seminars and workshops of the conference's technical forum, may be of great value to them later on.
and through them to the generations yet unborn. Ladies and gentlemen, the limitless expanse of the cosmos does not admit of borders or national jurisdictions. Space exploration has given us the opportunity to see the Earth for what it is in the context of the galaxies around us. A tiny sanctuary of life in the midst of the multitude of the heavens. Confronted with the vastness of the universe, we often feel our own insignificance. What we should feel even more is the absurdity of the divisions in our small world. Space is a resource we can all share. We must work together to unlock and exploit its secrets. We must ensure that no one is left behind as we move forward in the great adventure of exploring and developing outer space. I understand this conference is poised to agree on an action plan outlining realistic ways to make the benefits of space science and technology available to all. The Vienna Declaration, which will be adopted here, must be not just a form of words, but a living force which will change the lives of future generations. Tomorrow, in the midst of your proceedings, we shall observe the 30th anniversary of man's first landing on the moon. Let that memory inspire you as you begin your discussions. Because if I may paraphrase Neil Armstrong, the small steps you will take here in Vienna can lead to a giant leap for humankind.
President, Your Excellencies, distinguished delegates and representatives of all member nations and international organizations. It's indeed a very great honor for me and my country to have been unanimously elected as the president of the historic InnoSpace 3 conference, being held at the threshold of the next millennium, exactly 3 decades after Neil Armstrong landed on the moon to achieve a giant dream for mankind. I'd like to express my deep sense of gratitude and appreciation to all the distinguished delegates of the member states for entrusting me with the important task of presiding over InnoSpace 3. I take this opportunity to express our sincere thanks to the Austrian government, its leaders and people for extending their proverbial hospitality to all the delegates attending this conference.
Не считаю, экологическая деградация и лишение человека тесно связаны друг с другом. Если производство зерна в развивающихся странах не будет увеличено в ближайшие 5 лет, они не обеспечат продовольственной безопасности для своих народов, которая будет составлять до 9 миллиардов в 2050 году. Улучшение здравоохранения, образовательного уровня, квалификация всех народов, особенно женщин, это важный элемент стратегии развития для достижения экономического прогресса и улучшения перспектив жизни человека. Растущие проблемы человечества в будущие тысячелетия – это достаточные продукты питания, экономическая, здравоохранительная и экологическая безопасность, на надежной основе для всех народов мира. Начало полностью интегрированного устойчивого развития стало императивом, чтобы предотвратить катастрофический спектр или призрак вымирания в ближайшем тысячелетии. Основные аспекты долгосрочного устойчивого развития и ее стратегии должны основываться на парадигме технологических инноваций, экономического детерминизма, физических ограничений, возникающих из необходимости устанавливать равновесие между возможностью эксплуатации и восстановлением. К счастью, недавние достижения в применении космической ДЗЗ продемонстрировали огромный потенциал для новых стратегий устойчивого развития, если они соответствуют новым биотехнологическим возможностям. Активные национальные и международные усилия, особенно в последние два десятилетия, несомненно, позволили многим странам выиграть от применения космической технологии в некоторых областях. Хотя некоторые развивающиеся страны создали собственный местный потенциал по созданию и запуску спутников, другие используют коммерческие спутники, представляемые другими странами и международными организациями. Последнее развитие малых спутников, основанных на дешевле, быстрее и скорее, в принципе, облегчили экономически бедным странам получить доступ к космосу. Независимо от этого, воздействие космической технологии в развивающих странах остается минимальным из-за того, что они не могут себе это позволить, у них нет знаний, и они недостаточно руководящие лидеры недостаточно понимают эту проблему. Наше представление 21-го столетия должно основываться на достижении приемлемой качества жизни для всех народов. Космическая технология с ее доказанной возможностью сыграет решающую роль в качестве развития технологии в богатых технологиях информации общества будущего. Хотя искоренение неграмотности, начало устойчивого развития, достижение продовольственной и экономической безопасности, создание глобальной связанности и защиты экосистемы Земли, несомненно, основные задачи, которые предстоит решать, долгосрочные человеческие устремления, несомненно, будут включать промышленную эксплуатацию космического пространства с установлением полупостоянных космических станций и колонизации космического пространства. Образование – это ключ к развитию людских ресурсов у каждой страны, чтобы можно было оптимально созрело, превратилось в надежную конкурентоспособность, быстро растущую промышленность, которая может реагировать на потребности пользователей и на общей основе справедливое использование интеграции рыночной экономики, которая контролируемой космической промышленностью с экономической политикой во всех странах может быстро ускорить распространение космических выгод во всем мире. Основная задача Unispace 3 – это содействовать использованию космической науки и техники для решения проблем глобального регионального значения. Это требует укрепления потенциала всех государств-членов, в частности развивающихся стран, чтобы использовать...
Thank you. Thank you.
Designed for the young space professionals, but it is organized by that same generation. The alumni of the International Space University volunteered to organize this event
It was during Unispace 2 in 1982 that the idea was formulated to create a university to train young people in the international, interdisciplinary, and intercultural aspects of space. That dream was realized. We have come full circle. The graduates of that dream are now helping create the next dream. To the participants of the Space Generation Forum, welcome. You have come from rural areas and large cities. You have come from Northern Hemisphere and the Southern Hemisphere.
А кто на космосе? На станции Мир. У вас будет возможность пообщаться с ними. Пожалуйста, соблюдайте тишину, потому что иначе создаются помехи. Связь – дело тонкое. И всего-то у нас будет 5 минут времени. Ждем сигнала. Это Серж. Серж Платар в Вене. Добрый день, Жан-Пьер. Это Серж Платар. Я звоню тебе из Вены. Ты меня слышишь? Почти ничего не слышно из космоса. Я хочу тебе поведать пару слов. Мы в Вене собрались на слет молодых покорителей космоса. Приехало много молодежи, интересных людей, которые будут заниматься космической наукой. Они устремили свои взоры к тебе. Расскажи им что-нибудь. Слышу, но плохо. Кажется, понял. По-английски давай говорить. Жан-Пьер, вопрос. В ближайшие две недели более 160 представителей научной молодежи из 60 стран подготовят рекомендации Организации Объединенных Наций о том, как миру следует работать в космосе. Что бы вы порекомендовали?